G'day, welcome to the Bronia and Bayswater Community Church of Christ. Here we seek to love God and people as Jesus did. Here we want to connect people from the crowd to the core in Christ. And we want to grow through sharing the good news of Christ with those we live, laugh and work with. We hope you find this message uplifting today. Have a great day.
The Prince of Peace, that's what the angel said when he visited me in my dreams. Can I tell you something? I wasn't feeling peaceful. In fact, there was no peace in my heart at all. It was bad enough that I was getting married. It was a big change. I wasn't sure I was ready, although everyone told me it was time. I could stay the most eligible bachelor forever. But marrying Mary? She was beautiful to be sure. She was strong, courageous, a bit of a wildfire, if you know what I mean. I was worried about how she would cope in our little quiet family, and even more, how I would cope if she got bored. But then she came to me after we were engaged, and she told me that she was pregnant. I can't even describe how I felt. Was I angry? Yeah, furious actually. After waiting for the right woman for so long, I'd gotten engaged to that's what I thought then. She tried to explain to me about an angel and God's son, the Messiah, but I couldn't listen. All I could think of was how angry her parents would be at me, how the angry mobs could chase her down and kill her for bringing disrepute to our town. "Mary, you need to get away from here," I said to her, interrupting her tale about her cousin being pregnant. "Yes. Go to her, stay there a while we make plans." The plans I was actually making was how I could divorce her while she's away. So she packed up her things and headed out. Her father furiously loaded the wagon and away she went. Her mother refused to even speak to her. No one believed her, not even me. How ashamed I feel now about that. Poor Mary, on her own, dealing with the rejection of everyone who should have loved her. And she did nothing wrong. She simply obeyed God. I came to the realization myself a little later in the piece. I couldn't sleep. I couldn't work. I couldn't eat. I was anxious. Troubles were coming. No way to avoid them. My heart was full of fear and anger. My body was sick. My head was spinning so much that I thought I was going to be sick. So I had to take time off work to try and rest, even if I couldn't sleep. And it was then I was going over my plans to divorce Mary when I heard a breath, a sigh, a whisper. "Take her as your wife." Was I going insane? Had my brain malfunctioned? But it came again. "Take her as your wife." I looked around the room and there was no one. Then there was someone, a light, a man, a being, and he spoke to me. "This baby is the Son of God. You are to take Mary as your wife, and you are to raise the child as your own. His name is to be called Jesus, and he will save people from their sins." And then it was gone, just as it had came. Jesus, it means God's salvation. The baby is God's salvation, the Messiah, just as Mary had said. I remember that feeling when I had realized I had been looking at everything from the wrong perspective. I'd been looking at the situation from my own perspective, from the impact that it would have on me. But I needed to look at it from God's perspective. This is God's solution to our world's problem. This is the long-promised, long-awaited Messiah. This is Emmanuel, God with us. The baby is God with us. Mary, I knew it was time to take her as my wife. And I knew despite the opposition that everything would be all right. I laid back down, closed my eyes, and fell into a deep and peaceful sleep. And it was all right. I mean, there were challenges, like the trip to Bethlehem, like being a midwife for the first time, like having to deal with the way that everyone would be treating us. It was hard and it was challenging. But you know, from that moment, I realized God was with us. I had peace. Now when troubles come, I do get tempted to be anxious, but then I realize God's gift of peace through his son is not just a one-time thing. God continues to give me peace as I continue to trust him with my worries. God is with us. God is with you. On the first Christmas, God gave us a gift of peace through a tiny baby and for each of us to unwrap. I hope you can experience his gift of peace today.
The vapor of it all, it's a chasing of the wind, the powers of the earth, so pale and thin. We will set our hearts on you the hearts of men. We can feel it from within, the beauty of it all, the mystery, the swelling of a voice, a rising sea.
Was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Through him all things were made, without him nothing has been made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind, the light that shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. As these lanterns slowly, hey, there we are. There is something beautiful about light. There is something beautiful about what it does to us and what happens when we see it. Even in a season like this, there is something that happens when we see light. It's symbolic. It's a beautiful representation of what God is doing. Just hoping that I don't burn down the church, and we should be right. The light was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. And yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name,
He gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or of a husband's will, but born of God. And so the Word became flesh, and it made its dwelling amongst us. It's beautiful scripture, isn't it? Graham and I must have been on the same page today. Light is a deeply spiritual thing. It is both a concept and an idea. It is both it comes to signify peace and holiness and righteousness and hope. It does all those things. And it can bring a new awareness of kind of our own posture and our own hearts. Better still, it can be confronting and difficult to hold a hope in some difficult and troubling places. It's hard to do that, isn't it? And yet light attracts light. When they come together, we see a deeper glow. What begins as one light lighting up a room soon leads way for two and three and four and so on. Light attracts light. When there is light, there is hope. And where there is hope, there is a new awareness. And so John begins his gospel by talking about the Word, Jesus, the Word. Being in all things and through all things as an active participant in the reshaping of things to come. And though we may not have recognized him, though he may have seemed unexpected from what we wanted, he was different from what we wanted. Though he may have seemed silent through the times of darkness and pain, but John writes, the Word was there in the beginning. It was always there. We just didn't see it. Through all and in all, and participating through all things, the Word was there. It was there. We just didn't see it. And so we see the Word as light, shining in the darkness, fully prophetically through culture and people and time. Light shines brightly in this season. It's a contagious light. It is one that grows and grows and invites others to participate and partner with the rebuilding of our world. Light attracts light. This is a light that radiates broadly and brightly. It is a light that can be seen from far away, a light that cannot be fully understood, not fully, but we can know what it is and we can see its footprints. As the people of God returned from exile, they returned back to the land. They rebuilt the temple. They rebuilt the walls, didn't they? That we all know the story of Nehemiah. They began to get life back into order, but all was not well, was it? The prophets were silent. No words or songs, no stories, no prayers. There was nothing. For 400 years, there was nothing. There was nothing. The Persians still ruled, but there was nothing. The Greeks invaded their land, but still nothing was said from the prophets. The Egyptians raised up and threatened their lands, and yet still there was no word from God. There was nothing. The great revolt of the Maccabeans came with devastation, and still there was no word from God. And finally, the Romans invaded and conquered their lands. Still no word from God. And what do you do if you're those people in that time? Do you actually hit a point where you just kind of give up a little bit? What do you do? What sort of stages of life do you do? What cycles of life do you go through? The light was there. Surely it was there. But still, we didn't see it. There was nothing. Such was the life of the people so greatly oppressed. O come, Emmanuel. O come, we need you. And yet the light wasn't there. Surely the light is coming. Surely Yahweh has not left us. Surely the Messiah is coming. And what happens in these moments of desperation, not just for us as people, but as a culture, as a nation, it can be a story, is that people shift into a different mode of operating from their everyday experience. Like as a culture, you can do that. As a community, your way of operating can shift to try and process what is happening. And when people are pushed and marginalized and left desperate on the road, you know, the Jewish nation invaded again and again and again, oppressed and told to go back into their corner. Something happens in people when they go through that experience. They respond in grief and loss because they've lost culture. They've lost identity. They've lost story. That actually can happen as a community. communities go through that. It's almost like you can follow the various stages of grief and loss. A community can go through that, and they can hit a point where they get to the bargaining stage. We know the bargaining stage. People in communities come to a place where they try and rationalize things in a different way. And for a Middle Eastern Jew, desperation is preceded by bargaining to God for a long-awaited promise. And this is what happens, and we see this when Jesus, just before Jesus turns up. Religiosity becomes the only way, right? It becomes the story. If we pray hard, if we follow the rules enough, if we adhere to every possible rule that's there, if we become the strictest possible religious person we can, possibly the Messiah will turn up. Maybe that's what we need to do. If we become even more radical, even more religious, if we follow the rules enough, if we get enough people into the temple, right? If we do enough of that stuff, if we can kind of force everyone to be as religious as possible, surely then the Messiah will come. Like, surely that will fix our problems. Just maybe the Messiah will come. O come, Emmanuel. Do you see the train of thought there? Like, we still do that today. We still have that moment of processing the world, and sometimes we slip into bargaining. We still do the same thing. The light was there, but yet the light was not ready to shine. And it's here at the beginning of Matthew, in this part of the story, when all seems lost, that God chooses to make his move. The light comes, but in an unexpected way. It is here that the Messiah comes, to a people and a place where no one else is looking, where no one is watching. And this here is why I love the Christmas story so much. I love it. Every single year, I think something happened a few years ago and it just started to switch on for me. When you see the human aspect, when you look between the lines, when you just imagine a little bit what this story was like, it's actually extraordinary. This is why I love the Christmas story, because nothing happens as expected. Nothing happens as they wanted to. We see a real complicated people being used to glorify God. I'm looking at all of you because I'm seeing the same thing. The story hasn't changed, has it? We are used by God to glorify him. But it's never in the way that we expect, or the way in which the culture expects things to happen. So in the time of Matthew, the light comes. It shines brightly upon imperfect people, but in perfect ways. Yeah, we see the story and we go, yeah, that's how it should have been. Isn't it beautiful? Isn't it beautiful? Mary and Joseph were pledged to be married. They lived in what I'm terming a cul-de-sac religious and obedient community. They're actually quite a separate community. The folks in Nazareth, there was a community of faithful Jews that returned to there after Babylon. They moved there and they didn't stay anywhere else. In a time when your lineage was important, in a time when your lineage gave you identity and status and story, it actually gave you historical ancestry story. It's actually really crucial what we see in the story. The line of David, it's there. It's been hidden away, but it's there. That's royalty, that's ancestry, that's God's footprint, that's the light that's been there for a while, but we haven't seen it. And yet, within the scripture of John 46, it says, though they were from Nazareth, nothing good can come from Nazareth. Well, maybe. We'll see, I guess. We'll see. So we know the parts of our world. Yeah, nothing good can come. Joseph in particular is fascinating. I find Joseph a fascinating person. He's a faithful man in a time where, as I said before, lineage and identity says everything. He's from the line of David. He's from the royalty, the line that we follow. We don't know much about Joseph. We have to sort of interpret things a little bit. We don't know his exact age. But we see no mention of him after the cross. There's nothing there. For those that remember, that, you know, there's that verse where Jesus says to John, his beloved, which I'm sure John wrote, his beloved, this is now your son, right? That's it, an intentional part of the story. And Joseph isn't there. So we have to sort of make up things a little bit and draw some pieces together. But certainly, what we do know, Joseph could have been 20 of the appropriate age to get married. He could have been. Or he could have actually been older too. He could have already had a wife that may have died. We don't know. We have no idea. But what is interesting is the way Joseph responds is actually very different from a young man. The response of Joseph is mature and thoughtful, not the rush hastens of how I would respond. When Mary, the young bride-to-be, was found to be with child, Joseph is alarmed and I'm sure even a little baffled. What happened? Either way, Joseph was uncomfortable, perhaps even, maybe even heartbroken. Can you imagine that? Heartbroken for what's happened. And yet the response from him is not shame. It's concern. We don't see a shameful response from Joseph, but we see a response of concern. In Matthew 1:18, it says he did not want to expose her to disgrace. That's concern, isn't it? That's awareness of how things are playing out. Joseph knew the law. He knew what he was entitled to. He knew how these things went. He knew that the law was actually on his side. He actually didn't need much more of an excuse to divorce her or even send her off to be stoned. That was all within his purview. That was the way society worked. He knew too that by accepting Mary in her condition, it would not just be against the religious laws, but it would be totally against his worldview. It would be totally against everything that he had shaped his life upon, not just him, but his culture, his country, the way in which you worship and observe God. This was a grey area. And he would be going against that. For a good Jew, you would follow the rules. And so this pregnancy, it's a grey area. It's something that becomes incredibly uncomfortable. In fact, it's really you become a social outcast, don't you? I mean, just think about that for a moment, what that meant. And yet throughout the story, we see that it just doesn't end at that one point because God's not done yet. God's doing more. We see the profound maturity of Joseph on display, for the light was coming. It was coming. And now it was time. An angel visits Joseph and he brings a message of assurance. There is more to this story, Joseph. Mary has not been unfaithful. There is nothing to fear. There is no trust lost between you. This child is Emmanuel. This child is God with us. The long-awaited Messiah is coming. And it's easy to skip over this verse and miss the emotions at play. You know, people are complex. I don't know whether you've noticed that. Marriages are complex. Relationships are complex. We are complicated people. You don't just skip over these verses quickly and just assume it's all perfect. Not at all. If we draw down on the story, we can miss the personal responses that are so critical to this story. After the angel leaves Joseph, it says that he woke and he took home Mary as his wife. Now, I'm not sure about you, but I see, as I said before, there is profound maturity in his response that is not seen or expected at the time. And this just didn't happen. It just doesn't happen like this. So go on a journey with me here. If you're a good Jew and you follow the rules, because this will bring the Messiah, remember? Your understanding of the Messiah is swords, shields, army, blood, empire. That's how you understand how these things go. When you've been persecuted for that long, there is one narrative that wins, and it's empire, blood, armies. I mean, it's right throughout the Old Testament story. So why would the Messiah be any different? What the angel is asking Joseph to do is to actually put his entire identity at this point here and move all the way over here and be okay with it. This is huge. This is actually massive. And in doing so, what the angel is asking Joseph to do is to actually bear to believe that the stories of his tradition no longer have the right standing anymore. They no longer have the same meaning as they used to. That actually some of that stuff is no longer helpful. That's a profound moment. You don't just skip over that. There is loss involved in that, but there is also joy. I mean, can you imagine what you would do if you had Joseph's worldview? What would you do if you were in his situation? Can you imagine it? The whispers in the night, the prophetic step into faithfulness, Now, actively choosing to follow God, though the path may be messy, you know the path will be messy. You know you are stepping up into something that is uncomfortable. But you have enough faith and enough maturity to know, I believe God is doing something here. And I'm going to step on board. I mean, that is a beautiful story, isn't it? We do not need to skip over that story. What I see here is one man choosing to step up in faithfulness, actively choosing to follow God, though the path may be messy and the load may be heavy. And that is a lesson for not just Joseph, but for us. A beautiful reminder that the journey of faith sometimes calls us to make decisions we're not comfortable with. But when God is calling us to something, we are called to obedience. Henry Nouwen says this, "The Lord is coming, always coming. When you have ears to hear and eyes to see, you will recognize him in every moment of your life." This is Advent. Life is about recognizing the coming of the Lord everywhere you walk and see. Everywhere you walk and see. In other words, push aside our own expectations of what God looks like or the ways in which our traditions have formed our worldviews, because they have. Our traditions form us and they form how we see the world and how we understand things like faith and baptism and communion. Everything forms our worldview. So put that aside for a moment. What Henry now is talking about is rather, we're actually called to press in and to be bold and audacious and seek to find the footprints of God working around us. And in the story of Joseph, it happens in a very unlikely place. But actually, footprints signify not just the coming of God, but the coming of the Messiah. Joseph got that God was doing something different. And so what Henry Nouwen is talking about is be bold enough to ask the question, how can I see God moving in my neighborhood? How can I see God moving in all the conversations of my family, the way I spend my money? How can I see the Advent story being played out in every part of my life? Not just the religious part of my life. How can I see the God footprints everywhere, the coming of the kingdom, the light that is shining everywhere around me in the most unlikely places? It's an encouragement to be bold and to look further. It's an audacious prayer. We like uniformity in the church, in our faith communities. It kind of makes us feel good, doesn't it? Well, we all feel the same. We all drink the same good coffee. We all do the same stuff. It makes us feel good. Like there's actually something beautiful about communities that have this sense of unity together. It's a good thing. It's actually a really good thing. The challenge is, though, is it can actually get us into a place where we become too comfortable and we become too complacent. And sometimes God calls us in the middle of the night or in the middle of the day to see the new thing that is happening, that is different from the old, but is about the unfolding of light and hope in new and beautiful and dangerous ways. That's actually part of a community. We actually need a bit of push and pull. We need some of the prophetic voices that are kindly agitating a little bit and saying, I actually think God's calling us to do something different. We need those voices. We need things that give us flavor and life. We need the rigor of that because it grows our own faithfulness, our own relationship with God. And the difference is not an idea to be feared, but actually rather a continuation here of the prophetic stories. We're living out of that space. We're living out of that story that God is still stirring us up and still has something to say about us, because he does. He definitely does. So in the same tradition of Joseph and Jesus and the prophets of the Old Testament, we are called to live a life of seeking out the newness, seeking out the freshness, living a dangerous life in which we ask the question, what is God saying to us? What is God calling us to do that may be different from anything we've ever done before? And how do we find the light in the darkness? C.S. Lewis says this, don't shine so that others can see you. Shine so that through you, others can see him. The good news for us today, friends, is that we are called to hold light, to be bringers of light. Like many times in history, our world is troubled and has many dark places. Just like in the time of Jesus, our world is full of empire that seeks power and control and authority. Our world's full of that. It's not a new story. but my encouragement for all of us, the good news for all of us, particularly over your Christmas lunch tables. My encouragement for us, may God's love shine brightly through you. May you allow God's love to shine brightly through you. May God's never-ending love for the people of our world shine brightly through you again and again so that all our lamps light up the world. You know, the more lamps we have, it glows, it brings light, and suddenly we see this is the love of God. I love it. May you make space for God this Christmas. Now more than ever, our world needs light. A light to shine so brightly, just like Joseph, so that we are able to step out and see and respond to what God is saying. Now, this is a beautiful image. My son, seriously. This is a beautiful image. I want to finish here. This is, and it's a bit of artwork. That's Dorothy Day. If anyone knows Dorothy Day, incredible social rights activist. A woman, a Catholic woman who worked very hard to bring women in. The beautiful story of Advent, you know, if we were to contextualize this, we're talking about marginalized people. Within, you know, the first couple of chapters, they need to flee their homeland because Herod's a little bit jealous. So they're homeless. They're asylum seekers. So if we want to contextualize this a little bit, this is a beautiful image for us to sit with. This is what it means to make space for God. This is what it means to make space in our hearts and our minds and our churches for the Christmas story that may have a different face, making room and shining light. Dorothy Day says this: "It is no use to say that we are born 2,000 years too late to give room for Christ. Nor will those who live at the end of the world have been born too late. But rather, friends, Christ is always with us, always asking for room in our hearts. Always. So may you make space. May you make room for him. May we make space in unexpected places, for the Lord is coming." And so I'm just going to light these three lanterns as a symbol of light and hope that is coming. I just encourage you, I've got three here. I'd love you to think of three people that you need to pray for while I do this. Three lanterns, three people that you need to pray for God's light. Father, we pray for our world. We pray for light. We pray for peace. We pray that your word grows and grows and grows. We pray for all the places in our world that are weary for war. We pray for all the places that are weary and in loss. We pray for places that do not have hope. We pray for places that need your peace. So, Father, this Christmas, we pause for a moment and we remember those in our world that need your light to shine brightly. O come, Emmanuel. Amen.